And therefore, bid in the Senate, we lend our full support to what the Nigerian Financial Intelligence Unit and PSC are doing, especially what they are doing. And I have no doubt that by the time you have the new Urubadu, being the chairman of PSC for 4 years, 8 years, you have Lamorin, being the chairman of PSC for 4 years, 8 years, and you have another person like him, being the chairman of PSC for 4 years, and we have people like that for over a period of about 24 years, you will see that you will no longer need a generator of Nigeria. And we pray that we don't need generators. And we pray that our people, especially people in the lower areas, who are suffering because the wealth of this nation does not percolate down due to corruption. And this also applies at the local government level. The local government gets a lot of money, but because people at the local government level are too powerless and voiceless, there's nothing they can do. So I believe that it will begin to ensure that people at the top, that is, we have governors and legislators and ministers who are straightforward, then people at the local government level will have to be straightforward. For instance, if you have a governor who is going to ensure that any local government chairman who steals public funds is sent to jail, then you are going to find that the money at the local government level is going to calculate. And that has socioeconomic consequences. Because the reason why a lot of people move into Lagos or that part of Abuja is because the rural areas are not working. There's no telephone, there's nothing, there's no job. So corruption, fighting against corruption, is key to the existence of socioeconomic stability in Nigeria. And we in the Senate and the National Assembly in general will spare no efforts in ensuring that the anti-money laundering laws and the war against corruption and drugs in this country is fought and won. Thank you very much.
What I got here, Mr. Carroway, the first introduction to the American administration. Thank you. A very good Oscar. I think President Ford is doing a good job. And some of us who have been close to you already know your attitude, know your stance on the issue of money laundering, corruption, and private money. What I want to say here is that I just want to find out from you. I know it's not always easy personally to pay to come and ask. It has to go to so many things and so on. But I'm wondering if there's nothing you can do in the National Assembly to fast-track that process. Right now, we don't have a way to do and so on. I'm aware that we have some proposals by way of amendments to smoke grandmas, gas, government business. So I've been in the country for years, those like the last 9 years. And the longer they take, the worse for the economy. So I'm just wondering whether there is anything you could do in the assembly to combat the process of passing bills into us. Thank you.
Representing the Association of National Accountants of Nigeria, Anna. I would like to know what happens to the forfeited assets, because we keep hearing that somebody has forfeited assets and a well-placed person in society has bought these assets for a peanut, which means indirectly the person is equally guilty of that offense. And number two, question related to that, why is it that nobody has actually been punished in this country for corruption? I mean, really punished. Not sending a person to jail for 6 months after stealing 18 billion, has been in detention for 5 months, and just additional 1 month you set him free. When in the prisons you have people who have stolen yam, chicken, goats, and they are being left there because of the corruption.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Daphne Nolan, representing AFCON here. I'm actually very happy that we have representatives from the Ministry of Justice, we have a representative from the police, we have a representative from the Senate, and we have NFIU. When Commissioner Police Balogun was talking, he mentioned on the 8th of May 2003, that's about 5 years ago coming up, there was meant to be a meeting to pass the Anti-Corruption Act. I'm praying that with every representative here present representing everybody, that I hope that we are honest and we actually want to do something about corruption, and they will actually pass this law. Because obviously personal interest has been taken, and how the law will actually affect them is obviously the reason. There's no point of dilly-dallying. If everybody wants this done, the newspaper articles, let everybody here write a paper in the papers, okay, and put some pressure on the National Assembly, and put some pressure so that this law is put into place, such that we actually have some hope for Nigerians in the terms that we have a shared strategy. When we talked about strategy, it's simple, have the act passed, and let people know what the repercussions are. We also do know that the penal system takes 8 years for cases to be tried. What is the Ministry of Justice doing about the fact when clear-cut cases, you have evidence, you have the assets to prove it, that people can't explain, can't you put a time limit to all judges such that these cases are speeded up, and as such, the acquisition of the assets are done as quickly as possible? Another suggestion with EFCC on the issue of properties being seized. I would suggest that open bidding, all the properties seized are listed, okay, and you actually have open auctions so that there's a transparency in terms of features. Let there be some real wanting to change the system in terms of speeding up cases and judiciary process. I'm actually very happy as to what SFU, the boss of the SFU, Stephen Balogun, did say as to what their actions are. And I hope it was obviously clear to all of us here that there's actually no cooperation between agencies, that rather than calling us the topic to brief us, that they actually have more interdepartmental talks within hands as to how they want to go forward on corruption. Thank you.
There has been so much talk about the freedom of information. And we all know that corruption thrives basically where there's secrecy. I want to know what the Senate is doing about passing that freedom of information bill
in the legislative process. I'm also convinced that there are obstacles and hindrances. First of all, we work in democracy. Every time you have a bill or a measure, there are people that will be for, there are people that will be against. And because we're in democracy, we must listen to everybody. We need to have a public hearing so that we listen to all sorts of opinions from all over the country. So the process is slow, and it's slow in many parts of the world. It's particularly slow here in Nigeria because of what I call the Nigerian factor. Which is that, for instance, I'm a new senator. I was elected last year. And in the Senate today, 80% of us are new, or 75% at least of us are new. Which means that if you have a bill that was supposed to have been passed and it's reached a particular point, and then you have an election, and then you have 75% of the senators being new, it means that those new senators have to go back and try to learn and see what had happened before. And I say it's a Nigerian factor because in other parts of the country, in other parts of the world, you have people who have been senators for 25 years. Senator Ted Kennedy has been a senator for about 20 years at least. But in Nigeria, you have a situation in which a community says, okay, you have been a senator for 4 years. It's now the turn of the other people in my community. And they don't care that the man who has been the Senate for 4 years and has acquired a lot of experience needs to be there to make that place function better. They don't care. The most important is that my own side of the central district must now produce the Senate. That's part of the problem that we have. I'm not very familiar with the process, but under the law, once property is sold, the money should go to the consolidated revenue fund. That's where it should go. The third question is why a lot of people are not calling for corruption. I think it's just a matter of political will. I mean, I have read the Nigerian Constitution, and I remember that in 1989, I was in the Coastal Assembly. At that time, I was 34 years old. And one of the measures I proposed, as a very old lawyer in that case, was that if you are retired from public office, and after you retire, because the law then was that if you retire, all you have to do is that after you retire, you declare your assets. But if you declare your assets, and then 10 years later, or say 6 years later, you start flying around in jets, the law did not make any provision to ask you how you were able to acquire that money in such a short period. Nigerian Constitution did not. So I proposed an amendment to the Nigerian Constitution that even after you have left, if it is the opinion of the Code of Conduct Bureau that even after you have left office, you could not explain how you were able to acquire those assets, that the law should be able to go after you. I remember a lot of retired counselors who were, and then senior public officers retired who were in the Coastal Assembly then. He said, look at this small boy. He wants to be running, he doesn't want us to enjoy our retirement. So I believe it's a matter of political will. I mean, you have had the Code of Conduct Bureau since 1979. I must confess, they haven't done much. For instance, again, one of the proposals that I had was that you should shorten, and I've come to the issue of the Freedom of Information Bill. Now, in this country, everybody knows everybody. You are a chairman of the local government, and you are worth maybe 100,000 naira, and within a year, you start building a house, a mansion in your village. Now, the Code of Conduct in Abuja is unlikely to know what is happening in my village in Ekiti, for instance. But the man in the village does not have the resources to go to Abuja to go and report what is happening in Ekiti. But what the Nigerian Constitution up to today provides is that if you want, if you want to know how much that chairman is, has declared, you have to come to Abuja, swear to an affidavit, go to court, and then they will make, and then based on money, then they will make the information available to you. That is obviously an obstacle, because I don't see a villager coming all the way to Abuja to come and take a picture so that somebody can come and assassinate him. So we have, that's why I said the issue is more political way. If we are serious about what is happening, then we should make the system so easy that can expose corrupt people. And that's why I support the Freedom of Information Bill. Again, the National Assembly was working on it in the previous session, but we are new now and we're going to start working on it again. I think the final, the other question is the measures we're taking to fast track the conclusion of cases. As a lawyer, I would say that I agree that the judicial process is extremely slow. I remember as a young lawyer practicing with my father. My father was handling the case, land case in Lagos, and the case was adjourned. And it got long story short. The case, by the time I got the hearing notice about the case, 23 years had passed. And the case was about to start after about 3 or 4 or 5 lawyers had died. So the judicial process in Nigeria is extremely slow. And it's a thing that feeds on itself. Because the judicial process is slow, people now want to utilize this to slow down cases. Let me give you an example. I was in the UK about 5 years ago and had a relative of mine said I should conduct a case for her. And I got to the court, and the lady judge said, yes, this thing was not verified by your relative. I said, I agree. And then she said, how many days do you require to correct it? I said, 1 week. She said, no, we find it tomorrow. I was shocked. And then I found the thing, typed on laptop, and we sent it to the other lawyer by fax. She adjourned, that was a Tuesday. She adjourned the matter to Friday. was a case in which Barclays Bank of Nigeria said that Marietti was owing money even though they were not owing money. So the Barclays Bank of UK said Marietti was owing money even though they were not, and I knew that they were wrong. So she said we should file the case and serve by fax. We served by fax and said we should come back on Friday. On Friday, I got the judgment of the Barclays Bank struck out. If that was Nigeria, that case would have taken at least 2 years. Now, the question is, because you know that this case will take only 5 days, you are not going to be wasting time. You are not going to plead guilty because you know you are going to be found guilty and the case will be found guilty. But when you know that the case will take like 5-6 years, then you will be using all sorts of tricks. So we need, I'm sure my colleagues, the lawyers, I can say my colleague at the Ministry of Justice, will do something about this to fast track cases in court. I, as the chairman of the Senate Committee on Drugs, Financial Crimes and Corruption, I'm also working now to fast track to amend the legislative process so that you can also fast track the way assets are recovered. And I'm in touch with the equivalent of the chairman of the SEC in South Africa to learn from them how they will be able to do this. So I want to assure the audience that we in the Senate are committed to make sure that we get the best out of the system. Thank you very much.